So if Arjun see his cousins and then he attached himself to them, that is the first thing. But the second thing that he is also see the Atman inside them as well. So
It's good because I will answer your question because that is the next point that I am raising. First, I have talked about sannyasa. Now, I am elaborating how you need to look around. First is me, my self-control, my mastery over my own ego and sensual pleasures, that is my desires and ego. When I have that control and I am doing the karma yoga, what is the next? Which starts with chapter 7, 8, 9. But it starts in chapter 4 also. The next point Krishna raises is very critical. Now he is talking about dharma. He said, what is dharma? I told you dharma of an artist, dharma of a teacher, dharma of a mother, dharma of a father, dharma of XYZ. How do you see that dharma? The dharma world, your duty, your responsibility, your role, your karmas should be harmonious with the cosmic karma. What is cosmic karma? What is divine karma? I am not using word divine, that will make it religious. Forget about divine. In line with nature, how do I say my dharma is in line with the nature? This is the next question. Dharma is talking about everything around you. I cannot say that chocolate makes people happy. So tomorrow, my dharma is to just bring 1,000 chocolates and keep distributing every day to everyone because that makes them happy. Is that your dharma? You will say no. You know what is there. Tomorrow, you say there are some people who they have a forest, and when they cut the tree, then they sell the wood and they get money. Then they can feed their families and they are happy. So let me get them an automated saw. So we can just clean it up in 2 days and they'll get a lot of money. Is that right? See, I'm raising you some interesting questions. You start thinking about it because this is what is the theme next. How to define your dharma, whether it is in line with the mother nature, whether it is in line with the life around you. Only I will survive. The rest I don't care. That is that ego-centered approach. I will become rich. I don't care about others. That is ego-centered. I will destroy all other countries. I want to be very safe, secure. I am the best. This is inviting for destruction. What I am saying is, Krishna has introduced a concept of balance in everywhere, everything outside. Harmony, everything outside. And your dharma should be able to maintain that balance and harmony outside. I cannot say someone who likes smoking and because he smokes, is very happy. So let me do a karma yoga of giving 2 packets of cigarettes every day to him, free of cost. You cannot make that a dharma. You understand that? Someone is a real, like a person who is killing other people. I cannot say that I'll give him a lot of good food and a lot of good things and I'll give him shelter, I'll do this for him, I'll do that for him. Because it's my dharma. Your dharma is to make sure that everything is in balance. There he defines what is good and what is bad. What is good? A good that allows you and me equal rights. an environment where you can grow, I can grow. An environment where you have freedom, I have freedom. That is a balance. Where one tree is cut, one tree is planted. That is balance. Then I get $10. I spend $5 for those who don't get it. That is balance. And in that concept of balance, Krishna asks Arjuna, what is the situation with you? Arjuna is saying that I am a king. He says, what is the role of a king? Is to take care of people, to protect them, to give them equal opportunity, to protect the pride of women. It's one of the main first purposes, objectives of a king in Indian this ancient system. In fact, Krishna's understanding of a beautiful place to live, heaven to live, is where women are worshipped. Yatra Nagesu Pujante Ramante Ratra Madhava. He says Krishna stays there where women are worshipped. They are having higher respect than men. That is a heaven on earth. With this definition, we can understand. Right now, see the places where women have more respect. You will see they are the countries where people are happier. Where there is more abuse to women, countries are not happier. Not happy. There's a chaos. There's stress. It's an interesting side that he is looking at. So he says, when you are part of family, you cannot overlook family welfare. When you are part of society, you cannot overlook society welfare. Just because I am an artist, I am just doing this, that doesn't end my karma. I have to look to all the directions that I possibly can. Then he asks Arjuna, you are a warrior, you are a king. What is your role and responsibility? It's to protect my people, to make sure everyone gets good opportunity, everyone has freedom, everyone respects other life. And then Krishna asks him, are you doing your duty now? If you let the Kauravas run away with the war, what will be established in the society? The truth that people will learn from this experience is, if you are good, you will be always a failure. The right path will be defeated. What is the right path? All this. Why? Because that is your dharma. He doesn't say, if you were a teacher, you should raise the war. Mahatma Gandhi felt that he believes in non-violence. So he fought the war with physical, like abstaining from physical violence. But in reality, as per yogic texts, it was violence. On a mental level, it was extreme violence. And there Krishna says that when good values need to prevail, always it has to be through struggle and fights. There have been no time on earth when good, positive values were established without struggle. No time. Never it happened. Because that's a nature. That's how it is. He says, don't have the concept of God like someone sitting in the heaven and being compassionate on you. God is not that. It's an energy. Energy can be positive, can be negative. If the energy is expressed through desires, it becomes negative. If the energy is expressed without desires and ego, it becomes positive, life sustaining. This is where he is bringing in a justification for the first time to Arjuna, that what you are doing is not for your desires, is not for your ego, But you are doing it because that is your dharma. Otherwise, who will establish the positive values in the society? Is there a choice? Is there an option? There is an option. Your wife, Arjuna's wife, Krishna is telling, your wife was humiliated. She was undressed and they dragged her naked in front of thousands of people. If that's what the kingdom is going to be, if the queen has no protection in the rule of these Kauravas, if she is humiliated to this extent, what do you expect about a common woman, common lady? And you walking away, you running away, will establish a wrong train. You will support a very wrong tradition. So this is how we justify Arjuna, that he has to stick to his path, but with no attachment. And then he says that any karma, whether it involves killing, if it is supporting life, if it is positive for health, you have to pay that. Like you gave me the example. Gangrene, I told you that other day, gangrene leg. You have to amputate, you have to cut it. You don't want that to spread all over. And Krishna is telling that we are all one. Kauravas are not different. It is just a desire and ego overpowering their wisdom. There is a verse in Mahabharata when Duryodhan is asked by Krishna, do you know what is right or wrong? Do you know what is good for you? And Duryodhan answers very nicely. You can remember this. Janami adharmam nachame nivrutti. Janami dharmam nachame pravrutti. I know what is right, but that doesn't attract me. I know what is wrong, but I cannot leave it. I cannot go away from it because that's my identification. That's where I identify myself. An alcoholic will give you the same answer. Drinking too much? I know it's bad. Why can't I? Where I need to drink? How to change this? I dare not talk. I'll finish my point and then stop.
I was going to ask you about death penalty.
If you want to change this state, the whole path of yoga is described, which involves Hatha Yoga, which involves Ashtanga Yoga. And when you are practicing Hatha Yoga and Ashtanga Yoga, along with it, more powerful and even an advanced stage is Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga. Because that will bring the clarity to your mind and it will sustain your level of achievement. And that is in reality, should become your main path. Because that you can do even while you are eating, that you can do even while you are talking to your wife, that you can do even while you are doing work at your workplace. One interesting question that was asked to me some time back. If I am doing a work selflessly, and if I am doing a work without any attachment, can I work in the office of a drug dealer? I can do it. My dharma is to work and support these 100 people. Can I do that?
If your answer is no, then what Krishna told Arjuna, that fighting the war should be your answer. These two are justified. Think about it. You raised a very critical question to me, which I feel is the very genuine question. How can you justify war? That's what she asked. That's what will be in many of the minds here. I'm telling you this question. This is how it can be justified. Okay, your question.
No, it's the same.
Death penalty.
No, it's is allowed the same.
Death penalty to whom?
Yeah, in general.
A criminal.
Same as war, like death penalty would be war against criminals. The same. There was just one person you kill. No?
There was this guy in America, Ted Bundy, if you have heard about him. He was a psychopath. You heard about him?
Yeah.
Ted Bundy. Yeah. Ted Bundy. He used to feel joy when he used to cut women here and then the blood used to come out. He used to feel that thrill and joy. He killed more than 18 women. A death penalty to him. Was it justified or not justified? I'm asking you.
What is the question?
Not justified. What do you want to do with him?
No, because he's sick, so you have to put him somewhere. Just definitely don't let him loose, but you got to put him somewhere.
And feed him.
And then just till he dies, yeah.
But what will be the, achievement for him in that life?
Start him to do some asanas, pranayama, and everything. What's going on with him?
If that person is inclined to do that, I'll tell you another story that supports what you guys are saying. There was a story of a bandit called Valiant. He was a terrible, horrible man who had killed so many people. With killing of one person, he used to put one pebble in a big pot, and his pot was full. He had killed so many people and he used to rob them. You know the story of
Ramayana. Isn't he the guy who wrote that? Isn't he the one who wrote the Ramayana?
Valmiki Ramayana. But then, you see, when Narad came, his guru, when he went there, this guy stopped him and said, "Give me what you have, I'm going to kill you now. And even if you don't give, I will kill you and then I'll take it from you." Narad smiled at him and said, "You want to kill me? Kill me." He was shocked because before Narada, everyone who he said, "I'm going to kill you," were scared, started running or wanted to fight. Narada said, "Okay, kill me." Then because of that sudden different reaction, this Valya became, he asked him, "Are you not scared of death?" He said, "No. I will be dead today or tomorrow. And you will also be dead today or tomorrow." The moment he said that, this Valya realized that, yes, he is not scared. And I am more scared now because he stopped fighting. Then this Narada had some philosophical discussion with him. And then this Valya came to a realization when his wife refused to take part in the killings, when his father refused to support his killing, when his wife said, "I don't care what do you do, it's your dharma to feed me and my baby and your father. Why should I support you killing people? That's bad." That's when he felt that guilty consciousness. He said, "This is what I'm doing is wrong." When a person feels that, then person need not be killed. Because he will walk on the right path after that. The problem with Bhishma, problem with Dronacharya, problem with Duryodhan, problem with Kauravas was, despite of all the indications, all through the 14-year period that went behind that, every time the opportunity was presented to them, they refused to take it. There has to be a limit. Ted Bundy,
if you give him someone to train, and if it's a lady, he might kill her. Because he never thought that what he did was wrong. That was all the acceptance. I studied that case, so I know what was the case. He never accepted that as something wrong. If you accept something is wrong, then you are a completely different person. You know, in Pandava's case, Krishna had given an offer. Krishna went as a peace messenger to Kauravas. In front of Bhishma, in front of Dronacharya, he requested the Lion King. Krishna was a very powerful warrior at that time. He was acting as a peace messenger. When Krishna used to enter the parliament, even Bhishma would offer his respect, even when Bhishma was much elder to Krishna. So Krishna had that respect. With that respect, Krishna went to this blind king and Duryodhan and told him that you are so attached to the kingdom which belongs to Pandavas. If you want, keep it. Just tell, promise that you will give them very small piece of land where they can live and they can practice their yogic techniques. I assure you, they will not fight against you. That was the peace message that Krishna carried. And what was the result? The result was Duryodhan shouting and ordering his guards to arrest Krishna because Krishna was talking from the side of Pandavas. Such a high level of arrogance, which is beyond the bear, has to be destroyed. That arrogance cannot rule the country, cannot rule the kingdom. That arrogance, with that arrogance, you cannot risk millions of lives. This is exactly what happened in the Second World War. That arrogance, how many lives were lost because of that arrogance? It was just arrogance. There was nothing else. Don't you think so? Or ego? Me? I am superior. That was all. There was nothing else. So if someone would have taken a decision, if Krishna was there, what he would have done? What has he justified in Bhagavad Gita is dharma, the concept of dharma. And that is such a broad that it applies to everyone, everywhere. Now, I was telling you Krishna's story, which I am starting today. What is Krishna and who, from where he comes in? He discussed about Pandava and Kauravas. When Pandavas were born, exactly at the same time, in another part of India called Mathura, near Delhi, Mathura, there was another kingdom. There was a king. His name was Kans. Kans. He was the ruler there. He used to. And he was a bad man. He was exactly like the bad, aggressive, arrogant, very inhuman approach. He had a sister, and his sister's name was Devaki, and she was very sattvic. She's very pure and a very nice lady. She was his sister. She never liked what he was doing, but then he was very fond of her, and then he was really attached to her. So it was an interesting relations. One day he found out one guy that was very good. His name was Vasudev, which this Devaki liked, and he married both of them. He was very happy that it's the day of my sister's wedding and all that. So there was a big procession that he was leading. He was a king, and the procession of the marriage was going on, and he was distributing lot of money, lot of things to people, because he was very happy for his sister's marriage. In that ceremony, there was Akashavani, like some divine sound came from this sky. And what the sound said was interesting. The sound said, "Hey Kans, you're so happy, you're taking the procession of the marriage for your sister. But you don't know, her eighth son, he's going to kill you." And that shook him. And he was really pissed. He said, "I don't believe this. I defy God's word. I don't care." So what he did was he put his own sister that he loved most on the day of the marriage into the prison. He loved his sister, so he was not going to kill his sister. He put them in prison, his sister and her newly wed husband. The first baby was born in prison. He laughed. He brought the baby and he killed the baby. He said, "Is it the eighth one?" No. Haha, killed it. Six babies were killed. Seventh baby, she was pregnant. His sister was pregnant. And the seventh baby just somehow disappeared. That didn't surprise him. He laughed and he said that the one who made the words from the sky is scared of me. He was so arrogant, so egoistic. He said, and when the eighth was due to be born, there was much more security and everything was under surveillance, and he was like day and night keeping in vigil. Some interesting things happened on that night, and the eighth son was born, but he was taken away by his father because some internal things allowed that son to be escaped along with the father. So the father took the son out and he went to his friend in the night. Interestingly, on the same day, another baby girl was born to his friend. And he said that everyone in this kingdom knows that the eighth son is going to kill this king who is bad. Now you have come out and you have brought the eighth son. So what are you going to do when he finds out tomorrow that the son is not there? He will kill you, and probably he will kill all the babies that are born on that day. So you better take my girl and leave the son here. So the son was left there and the baby girl was taken away. And in the morning, when they heard the cry of the baby, the news went to the Kans that the baby is born, the eighth son, your enemy, the one who is going to kill you. But it's not a boy, it's a baby girl. So he started laughing. He said, "Oh, they are scared of me. Instead of a boy, a girl is born." Then he said, "Still, it's it. I'll kill it." Tried to kill it. Something interesting happened. And the baby just vanished. And there was again a sound. The sound said that, "You idiot. You think you can defy your destiny, which is not possible. Your enemy is safe and sound and he's alive." That scared him. Then he tried to search all over his kingdom for the babies who are very special. And where this eighth baby was kept, the eighth baby is no one other than Krishna. That is the birth of Krishna. Eighth baby Krishna, though he was born to royal family, he was being kept by his father with his friend. And the friend was from a small place called Gokul. Gokul was a community of cowherds. Cowherds, the ones who take care of cows, they milk the cows and sell the milk and the butter and buttermilk and ghee, which you all know. Some of you at least enjoy. So Krishna started growing up there. There were many attacks in Gokul because Krishna did display some special qualities as a baby, as a child. He had that very special catching energy. He would catch people easily, their attention, and he would make them smile, get attached to him. So of course the news was there, but at that time Kans did, he was not sure, so he was not going to kill, because politically if he would kill, then it would attract the wrath of the people from Gokul, and they were supplying the milk and milk products to his kingdom. So he was playing a little careful gamble there. But anyway, Krishna started going there. There are numerous stories. The stories of Krishna's childhood, if I start telling you, make sure it will be more than 18 days. Every day 3 to 4 hours. I'm telling you the fact.
Is there any book that collects stories?
There will be childhood stories of Krishna, lots of books.
And the Srimad Bhagavatam.
Bhagavad Puran.
Yeah.
What you were saying that day when I said it's in Bhagavad Puran, not in Mahabharata.
Yeah.
In Bhagavad Puran, these stories are there. And they are all like interestingly painted story. What Krishna displayed from the childhood though was he was a leader of everyone. Elder people, they were attached to him. Girls, they were attached to him. Boys, they were attached to him. They all liked him. Whatever he would say, they would do it. Like he was the only leader who had like a young child, and he would tell his friend, steal the milk, steal the butter. Because the milk and the butter, his logic was very simple. He said the milk and butter belongs to either the calves, and after the calves it belongs to the kids. Why it has to go to the king? It's injustice to the people who live here. They need to be strong and healthy. But king was not that good. So that was a rebel against the king. So he is shown as a thief. Now that theft, is it a bad act or a good act? When you consider the rights of people there, then you understand it is the right thing to do in that situation. But if you go technically, stealing is bad. But was it stealing in Krishna's eyes? So no. So the development, he tried to gather all of them, he tried to teach how a group, people staying together, living together with a common goal can help each other. That was a classic example. The life of Krishna in Gokul was a classic example of that. And by the time when he was growing up, slowly Kans understood that it is this boy who has shown these extraordinary abilities with management, with leadership skills, getting people together. And by that time, he had got such a huge support in the kingdom that it was difficult for Kans to wage a war or arrest him or something. So what Kansa did was, he sent an invitation to Krishna. What was the invitation for? The invitation was for wrestling, like open challenge of fight me. But he challenged them in a sport. That time there was also sport. So Krishna went, Krishna and his brother, he had an elder brother. The elder brother was the seventh baby who vanished. And who didn't actually go down anywhere, it was transferred to another lady. So that was the surrogate mother concept. You know the surrogate mother? You know, right? It was similar concept there. But anyway, so he and his brother's name was Balram, they went to the king. And of course, it's a story that the Krishna went there, he won the battle there. And he defeated these two. He didn't kill them. But then after defeating these two, he challenged Kans directly. Krishna challenged his own uncle. And his uncle had no choice because he had that prestige. And he had to fight that. And Krishna killed him there. What was the logic? Instead of fighting the army and getting into big killings, challenge the one person, separate him, kill him. And he didn't become the king. He made Kansa's father, who was put in the prison by Kans, and that guy was Krishna's grandfather. Because it was, that guy was his mother's father. He made him king. What that attracted was Kansa's wife. She became a widow. Now this wife belonged, she was a daughter of a very powerful king. That name of the king was Jarasandha. Another powerful king. Now that attracted anger of Jarasandha. Krishna killed Kans and made the daughter of Jarasandha widow. So Jarasandha was angry. And he started attacking Mathura. And people in Mathura started suffering. So what did Krishna do? He said, let's change the kingdom. See the vision. He said, this king is so powerful. We don't have enough resources to fight. And he is angry with me. And for me, why my people need to suffer? I will move to another place. That will immediately stop the attacks of Jarasandha. Jarasandha was another baddie in the list. He had captured about 98 kings from different places, and he was going to offer them as a sacrifice to the fire because he wanted to be the undisputed emperor. So he had those plans. So he was again a baddie, bad guy. But to stop that, Krishna didn't wage a war against him. He said, no, war is not a choice. I want to isolate that. So he left with some of the people and they established another kingdom called Dwarika. He left Mathura. He left Mathura altogether. That avoided mass conflicts. He was a very intelligent politician. He was just not a kind of manifestation of divine and like incarnation of God and all that. He is called incarnation of God because of his actions. Very, very politically sound decisions. What did he do with Jarasandha after that? Once he shifted the kingdom, once he safeguarded the people, what he did was he got Arjuna and Bhim with him. And three of them changed the dress. They dressed up like Brahmins. They were warriors. But they dressed up like Brahmins. And went to this Jarasandha and asked for alms. Now there was one weakness of Jarasandha. And the weakness was, if a Brahmin asked for alms, anything the Brahmin would ask, he would give them. That was only a good point. One good point about Jarasandha. The rest all was bad and terrible and horrible. So they asked for alms. King Jarasandha said, okay, I'll give you what you want. All three asked him, war with you, fight with you, one on one. They didn't want to enrage or incite the army of Jarasandha because that was huge, which they could not fight. They had nothing against the army. they had everything against this guy. And then Jarasandha was so arrogant, so egoistic. He said, yes, but out of three, you two, that is Krishna and Arjun, you are so skinny and really weak and stupid looking people. To fight with you is my insult. This third one is a little big
guy,
Bhim. You know how he was. I'll fight with him. And then Bhim killed him in the war. In the one-on-one war. These are all political decisions. And then after winning that, after killing Jarasandha, what did Krishna do? That is another important issue. What he did was he made Jarasandha's son as the king. That is that unselfish, correct perspective that he had. He is not killed for the kingdom. He is killed because he supports this. And he freed those people. They were in the captivity. And he released them. Said, he didn't make them his prisoners. Now I am the winner. So I am your emperor. The army belongs to him. He said, your son. And Jarasandha's son is the one who supported Pandavas later on. So he didn't enrage anyone, he made friends. So anyway, this event of Jarasandha, just before that I'll take you and I'll tell you that how Pandavas and Krishna are related. Pandavas, their mother Kunti and Krishna's father, They were cousins. So Krishna was cousin of Pandavas. They didn't meet when they were children. But they met when Krishna got the name, when he killed Kans and he became famous. And Pandavas, when they finished their education, that time they met each other. And then the friendship started from there on. It was a relation, but friendship developed. And naturally Krishna had acquired a big, like lot of respect from many people. And of course, when it came to talking about right and wrong and philosophy and ethics and everything, Krishna became even more respected with his views and with his arguments and with his overall personality. Then, yesterday, I told you that there was an attempt to kill Pandavas. You remember this attempt? To kill Pandavas by Duryodhan. He burned the house of wax completely. And Pandavas were saved. But then, instruction to Pandavas by Vidur, the Prime Minister, the intelligent man, was not to come out in the open. So they were in hiding. So it was officially declared that Pandavas are dead. The moment it was decided, it was announced that they were dead, the same day, without any delay, the blind king took the opportunity and unilaterally declared Duryodhan as the prince. He was waiting for this opportunity. So he didn't even wait for that mourning period of few days. Who died was his own family, was the prince. He died in there. He didn't wait for that. That angered Bhishma. That angered Dronacharya. Dronacharya was still attached to the kingdom because he was employed by the king to train the kids. So he was connected with the kingdom. Dronacharya, who is Dronacharya?
The guru.
The guru. But they had no choice. They couldn't do anything. They just had to accept that Pandavas were dead. And so then Vidur was also very unhappy. He was thinking. He was planning his moves. Meanwhile, what had happened was, there was another kingdom. And from that kingdom, there was a beautiful princess. Her name was Draupadi. And this Draupadi, her marriage was decided. And that marriage was, she had a choice. I told you, they had choice that time. Women had choice. They could reject someone. No. Out you go. And there was no appeal against that. See, this princess Draupadi, her marriage was decided. She kept a condition to marry. What was the condition? The condition was, she wanted the expert archer to win this condition, because she wanted to marry the best of the archers. That was her wish. So condition was, there was a wax fish of wax, and it was revolving on the roof. There was a small pot of water, full of water, and the condition was, looking in the water, you have to aim up and pierce the eye of the wax fish. The one who can do this, she was going to marry. That was the condition that she put forth. So many kings went. Duryodhan went. So many other kings also went, because this, she was a princess from a very powerful kingdom, very rich and powerful kingdom. And they all wanted the friendship with that kingdom, and she was also a very intelligent princess, all these things. Vidur informed Pandavas that they should go and participate in this marriage ceremony. But they had changed their dress, and they were in the robes of Brahmins. They were not like the warriors, because they were in hiding. No? They were asked to be in hiding. So Pandavas also went there. Many kings tried. Everyone failed. And finally, Arjun was asked by his brother, it's your turn now, go and fight. The kings protested, they said, how can you allow a Brahmin to participate in this? But the king, the father of the girl, he said, shame on you all, none of you could do this. I don't want my daughter waiting here for marriage, and no one is in a position to achieve this. So he allowed this Brahmin. He was Arjun himself. Krishna was present there in that ceremony. As Krishna, this princess, Krishna was her cousin brother. Not from his father's side, but from his mother's side. See, Krishna was everywhere. And then Arjun did. He easily could achieve that task. And then when it was time to marry, then he explained that, I am not a Brahmin, I am Arjun. Then the king was very happy. He said, oh, so you are not dead? And the news spread that they are alive. But there's a little bit tricky thing here. Now she accepted Arjuna as her husband. So Arjuna took her back home. And his mother was there in a small hut, because they were still not in the palace. They were still in hiding when the marriage took place. They are still in hiding. Of course, they came out in open, but his mother was still somewhere. And then when he got this newlywed wife, this princess as a maid, and what do you call it?
No, bride.
Bride. Bride. So, and he said that I have got very special arms for you. And the mother, without looking, said, okay, divide it equally between five of you. And everyone was shocked. What is the mother saying? You cannot divide the property. She is a woman. How can you divide her and eat? So it was wrong of Arjun to say that, but then Krishna comes in. And Krishna tells them that it was the austerities and it was the wish and resolve of Draupadi in the last life to have a husband who is very wise and very intelligent and very balanced, a husband who is very powerful, a husband who is the best archer, and a husband who is very handsome. This Nakul Sahadev, they were handsome. The first three, they were not that handsome. But the last two, they were handsome. So Krishna says it was her demand to the Almighty that if I marry, I want this type of husband. And Krishna says she was very powerful. Because she was very powerful, the God granted her wish. But then God could not give all these qualities in one person. So he's given five people. That was her will. Now she can decide if she wants to marry you or just not marry you. So then Arjun gives her the choice, says, I'm sorry to have said this to my mother. I apologize, but you take your decision. And then she takes the decision that she'll marry and she'll be a wife of all five of them. So she becomes the queen of five of them. The news is already there in to Bhishma and Dronacharya in their kingdom that they are alive. Bhishma is extremely happy. Dronacharya is extremely happy. But blind king is very unhappy. And Duryodhana is absolutely angry and furious because it is his lot to kill. And now he can expect a war. They will come out and they will fight. You killed us. You tried to kill us. So he's a worried person. He's an angry person. He's aggressively trying to defend his position as a prince. Then the five come back, along with a newly made queen, their mother. They are welcomed by the kingdom. They come. The problems start there. Naturally, the king has to give the right, the prince, the position of the prince to Yudhishthira and take away, strip his son of the position of prince. But the king is not ready to do that. Bhishma says, what are you doing? Why you are hanging on to this unjustified decision? You have to reverse it. He is not ready to reverse it. Finally, solution is found. What is the solution? Which is not acceptable, but they still find the solution, which is very unjustified. The solution is divide the kingdom, keep the existing kingdom, the one that is prosperous, the one that is good, with the blind king and his son. And the one that is barren land, give it to Pandavas. Yudhishthir, the elder one, says, okay, I will accept. The remaining four, Bhim, Arjun, Nakul, Sahadev, they protest, they say, we don't want this. Krishna comes into picture again. Krishna says, this is for the good. If you want to create something,
on your own. Have something that is virgin. No one has ever touched it. No one has ever did anything on that piece of land. You can build a heaven there. Are you not confident about your abilities? And he inspires them. And they take it. They build a very beautiful new kingdom. And then it becomes very prosperous because of the vision of Yudhishthira. So many good people from different kingdoms, they come and settle down because of the rule of law, because of the freedom, because of the respect that is given to all of them in that kingdom, because of the care that the king shows to every one of them. So naturally in a few years, it becomes the best place to live. The other kingdoms are at the same level, or probably some are going down. This main kingdom is going down because of the stupid management of this blind king and his son Duryodhan. This kingdom prospers. Now when they are prospering, they are becoming rich, they are becoming big, Duryodhan wants to have that as well. He wants that kingdom as well now, because his kingdom is not as good as their kingdom. You see how things are moving. Now they cannot fight. Duryodhan doesn't want to fight because there is no reason to fight. Everything is good. He has got what he wanted. Now they have created from zero. There is no reason. They are not making any stupid mistake to incite Duryodhan. Yudhishthira was very, very careful person. He never hurt any king anywhere. He had the best of relations with everyone. So Duryodhan doesn't want to anger Yudhishthira and all of those kings who are friends with Yudhishthira. So what he does? He takes help from his uncle. This uncle is, the name of this uncle is Shakuni. This is his mother's brother. And he is another very crooked and wicked character. Very negative character. And what do they do? Is they do a lot of thinking how to plan to take this kingdom. And then they come to a point where they say that weakness of Yudhishthira. He is the strongest of the king. He is the most wise and powerful man. But he has a weakness. See, if you want to defeat someone, what do you focus on? Focus on the weakness. And what is the weakness of Yudhishthira? He has a habit of gambling. Gambling. So they invite him as a friendly king, because they have good relations now. There's no reason why they should have bad relations.